Welcome to the video. I see my role here in the world as working to normalize the acceptance of the fact that our salvation comes from receiving the gift of a new mode of perception, a stable mode of perception. And this comes from the Holy Spirit. This is not something that is well known. It is not something that is taught. It is not something that's accepted or understood. And so it's a steep, steep path for sure. What we need to do is to recognize what doesn't bring salvation. The belief that something can bring salvation other than a stable means of perception is arrogance. Because it means that we feel we can be the author of our own salvation. We can continue to use this training program of death, which is existence, and use it to teach us how to solve the continuity problem with reality. In other words, how to be similar to both existence, perception, and reality, so much so that we're able to drop perception. So I use different modes. I point out different modes. For instance, music. Music is a mode that many, many people feel is integral to our salvation, and that we can somehow use music to help us be truly happy and contented, etc. Not true. That's pure arrogance. And it goes doo wop doo wop wop wop. I saw you there. And so we have this real catchy music that people love, and I love it too. Everybody loves it. It has nothing to do with salvation. We'll never have anything to do with salvation. It doesn't save us at all. It doesn't turn our attention towards what does save us. And yet we keep playing this music over in our heads, thinking like, you know, yeah, this is going to do it. No, we are so frightened of the continuity problem that we try to stay as far away from any solution to it as possible. And we keep thinking that we can do it within the realm of what we know entirely, leaving out the problem of it has to, an intermediate step has to be similar to reality, has to have so much similarity to it that we're no longer afraid to set down perception. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. For the first time I'm in the room. So I grew up at the end of the doo-wop era and then into the 60s, with which the Beach Boys took the doo-wop sort of into pop, those kind of harmonies. And then of course the Beatles came and everything changed at that point. So my, you know, musical heritage, mine stretches back, because I've stretched in all different directions. But I haven't taken it forward because I realize that music doesn't save us. It's not it. And what we really want is we want salvation. We want salvation. We want to be free of this wretched training program which we call existence. And we want to be happy, truly happy once again. We don't want to feel threatened. We don't want to feel vulnerable. Okay, we really don't. We hate this. But we're afraid of eternal disorientation because we feel that we won't be able to figure out reality. Of course not, because reality is directly experienced. It's not figured out. So we try to soothe our upset and call this soothing of our upset salvation. So music can kind of distract us for a little while. Not really, though. I mean, even when we're singing a song, we still feel upset. Still feel terrible to be mama. I just can't find it. Nobody can find it because they're not looking in the right place. They're not looking for a new mode of perception. What they do is they take the as a given that we have to do it with this mode of perception that we have. It's a given. And from that given, that premise, then they say, okay, how can we please this mode of perception? And then that's when you have the shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, 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 shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. And it goes on and on and on and on. The first time I saw you, blah, 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 blah. And we think this kind of does something, we think. But it's using our perception, sensory perception. So we cater to our sensory perception entirely. With art, with music, with relationships, going places, working, hobbies, everything is catered to sensory perception except the spiritual path. And that brings in reason. Okay. And reason says, not in my house, not here. That doesn't work. That's never going to work. Reason is different than sensory perception. It's a different way of seeing. It's a way to inform you that we have to have a new mode of perception. So I'm just working to normalize this here in the world a little bit for you, because it can be normalized. I'm trying to normalize it for myself. The problem is that this world, it's so completely foreign to the world. You know, it's like you're treated like a Cinderella, you know, just, who are you? You got nothing of value here. You're such a foreigner, terrible foreigner. And then I tend to say, hey, folks, all right, let me sing you a song, too. And everybody says, oh, okay, that's good if you sing us a song. But they never get around to considering a new mode of perception. And I'm not talking about Google Glasses or something. I'm talking about a new stable mode, a mode of perception that's invulnerable, that cannot be harmed, that cannot be threatened, cannot be lost, cannot be damaged, that it's free, no cost, you can't lose it because of lack of payments. You can't lose it because of your behavior or whatever. No. Once you receive that new mode of perception, it's yours. It's yours. For as long as it is necessary. And that is until you're no longer afraid to set down perception altogether. Because reality is not perceived, it's directly experienced, it is known. It is not perceived. So again, that's why we're afraid of eternal disorientation should we let go of perception directly. So we don't have to let go of perception directly. However, we do need a new mode of perception that is stable. So I said, hey folks, I'll sing you a song and then we'll talk about this new mode of perception. And it never got around to talking about the new mode of perception. They said, no, play another song. You know, I like that one. Can you make that one a little better? Yeah, I'm almost there, but just, you know, I just need a little more music, and you get strung along for an entire lifetime. So I stopped my playing. I stopped trying to, you know, appease people through music. I tried to do it through art. I've been trying to do it through videos, all these ways. And it never gets around to people considering, hey, maybe we need a new mode of perception. Shoo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-shoo-bop. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-shoo-bop. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. song, Mr. Fantasy. Dear Mr. Fantasy, sing me a song. So, what happens is you come into the world, you want to introduce this truth to the world, make it less feel less alien, less foreign, as it were. And people say, whoa, we're not ready for that. Can you get us, help us out, sing us a song or something, something to calm us down? And I say, oh, okay, okay. So people say, yeah, I'll be an artist. I'll do art. I'll do something that you like. And then try to slip in the theme of a new perception. But you know what? They never get it. The mind just says, ah, that's just, I cannot go there. I cannot go there. I'm too scared. Well, there's no spiritual path then. Spiritual path is for those who confront their fears with reason. Not with music, with reason. That's why I can never be a good enough musician, because my heart wasn't into it. You know, I said, hey, I want to stop this and let's talk about what's really important. So, fortunately, you know. Otherwise, I probably would have gone on to be a musician for sure. Probably a pretty successful one. But my heart wasn't in it. I was only doing it to try and get people on my side. You know, because nobody likes to. I went to Japan and I was such a foreigner there. And I brought several guitars with me. And so wherever I'd go, I would play songs and play guitar for them, you know. And try to relax the mood so people would say, oh, you're not such a foreigner because you know, you're making nice music. And we it's the universal language, right? Okay, nice. So then you think, okay, can I say something now that I really want to say, folks? Have you relaxed a little bit? And say, now what about perception? You know, what about this? And like, what? Oh boy, oh, I got somewhere to go. You know, gone like a cool breeze. Even the great gurus, they say, ah, hardly anybody ever comes to them to really hear what they have to say. Everybody's coming there saying, hey, can you give me something to make my perception better? I mean, this sensory perception, can you give me something that'll make me feel more comfortable with it so I don't feel like I need to exchange it for a new perception? Yeah, but that doesn't work. What I can do is I can have the guitar, and I can have the art, and I can do this stuff, but I can also talk at the same time like I'm doing now about truth. Now, if you're able to put up with this, then you for sure are on the spiritual path. If you're able to put up with this, not only put up with it, but kind of get a sense like inside saying, yeah, I like this. This is good. Someone is finally taking a stand here and saying, no, music isn't the way. No, art isn't the way. And it's an actual someone who could be an artist, who could be a musician. I could have been, you know, any of that stuff. And saying, no, it's not it. It's not it. It's not it. And it may be part of you somewhere is saying, you know what? I like that. Reason is saying, like, hey, that's very reasonable, actually, very reasonable. I'm not dissing music, I'm not dissing art, I'm just saying it's not it. And in pointing out how we waste our time and how we keep demanding, no, I gotta have more music, I gotta have more music, I gotta have more music. And I don't know, I this is what we have to normalize, the new perception, that has to be normalized. In a sane society, it's normalized. The difference between a sane and an insane society is this issue has been normalized in a sane society. So people, you talk about it, and people say, yeah, I'm familiar with that. let's sit down and talk about it. Now, my big mistake was to believe that through the use of music, I could relax people, make them feel friendly and comfortable enough so then it could be introduced. And I just simply thought that if I was just, that the music was great enough that this would happen. And so I just constantly was trying to find a way to, how can I make music work? Never could find a way. And it drove me crazy. And my nerves, I mean, it just frayed my nerves, as it were. It doesn't work. Reason has to be there, okay? If you're not appealing to reason, you're not appealing to anything that's going to work for you. And people just demand better and better music, more and more sophistication, and then at some point more and more decadent, something that isn't, you know, the music keeps changing. So, no way can you go into this world to help with music as your primary aspect like that. Now, I tried not to, but eventually I succumbed. When I heard the Beach Boys, I said, wait a minute, that music just might do it. You know, I was determined not to do this, not to get caught up in music. But I remember I was about, I don't know, it was 1963 when I was about 7 years old, when I heard, I had a transistor radio out in the, it could have been 64, I think it was 63, but I heard I Get Around by the Beach Boys. Round, round, get around, I get around, yeah, get around, woo, I get around, round. And then it's like, it hit me. I said, oh my God, this is super simple, but very clever, very sophisticated, and very beautiful. I said, Mike, if I could just do music like that, then maybe people would listen to, you know, the spiritual truth that I came to help normalize. And that was my downfall. That was the beginning of my downfall, really. I can't blame anyone but myself and the Beach Boys. If it hadn't been for them, maybe I would not have fallen. Because what they did was actually they used church music. Nobody's really recognized this, but I recognize it very well, especially by attending Catholic Mass and being extremely familiar with the Beach Boys. The music they really use, the progressions, etc., are taken from the Christian liturgy of music, very much so. And what they did was they just put a sort of a rock and roll beat to it. But the thing is, when you're listening to the Beach Boys music, it almost sounds sacred. You say, wow, there's something sacred about this music. That's because it came, I mean, I listen to the songs in the Catholic liturgy, I say, oh my God, I could easily turn that into a Beach Boys song. See, they use these, so that is their secret. They crossed over, they used the sacred music and put it in the pop context, and that's why it hooked me. See, that hooked me. I said, hey, I can make sacred music and mainstream it, you know, into the pop mainstream, and then people would be turned towards the sacred, etc. But it didn't go that way, did it? And Brian Wilson had a, you know, terrible breakdown, actually, because he thought that he could just make this perfect song, you know, and really, he was a genius, there's no question about it. He was trying to find the perfect song that would turn people in towards something sacred, that he felt, you know, there's something there, he felt that I could, that we need to get in touch with. And, you know, it drove him crazy, he couldn't find it. And he just started gobbling massive amounts of LSD and acid and hallucinogens, etc., to try and find it, you know. And just horrible situation, actually. But I went through a terrible, horrible situation of my own because I felt like I could build on the Beach Boys, what they did, and refine it and make it better. That's my talent in music. My talent was to take the very best music of the past, refine it, build upon it, and make it even more exquisite type of thing. So I said, hey, I can make music better than the Beach Boys, but along the same line of that. So, because you have to tailor the music to your audience somewhat, and the audience gets shifting and changing. And it's like, wow, I said, wait a minute, it's going further and further away from this. And terrible, terrible thing, trying to find the perfect song. There is no perfect song, all right? There is no perfect song. Yeah. Music doesn't save us. What it does is makes us feel like we don't need to be saved. To the world, the perfect song would be one where we forget all about salvation. And we say, we don't need salvation, we have this song. See? We don't need a new means of perception. We have this song, that's good enough. We don't need to worry about the continuity issue. We have this song, that's enough. It makes me want to stay in this place forever. So I don't even have to go back home. I can just stay in this dream of death forever because I have this perfect song. That is what the musicians are really attempting. So when you try to make the perfect song, you know, it puts a tremendous strain on you, because for me, I was always listening to every music constantly, trying to refine it all and come up with the perfect song. But I didn't realize so clearly enough what was going on. I knew something was wrong, but I didn't quite know what. And I found, you know, just being used. Same with art, same thing. Artists are just being used. Musicians and artists are just being used by the ego, by arrogance, where people can say, if I just have a perfect work of art, I don't need anything else. I can stay in this death forever. I don't need to worry about the continuity issue. I don't need to go home. This is sufficient for me. It's good enough. So artist, create, please, for me. You must create. If you want to be my savior, you must create. If you want me to listen to your salvation thing, just create the perfect, and then I'll be saved, you know. So the ego tells us that we can be saved by avoiding the continuity problem, by simply remaining in the realm of death forever. That's the ego's goal. So if you want to remain in the realm of death forever, good luck with that. You know, your advisor is the ego, and the ego will certainly make it seem as though it's possible. But all the while, you're going to feel terrible. You're going to feel something isn't right. And you're going to be searching for that perfect song. And you're going to put those headphones on and you're going to listen to it and you're going to say, if it's just a little better, I'd forget all about my home. I'd forget all about reality. I'd forget all about eternal life. I'd forget all about all of that. And I just would finally, the right chord would be struck. And I'd never want to go home. I'd forget all about home forever. Continuity problem solved. Fear of eternal disorientation solved, right? That's the ego's plan. So the ego says to musicians, hey musician, play Dear Mr. Fantasy, play me a tune, you know, one that'll make us all happy. Maybe I can get that one. Funny thing is, I don't have it. I have everything but Dear Mr. Fantasy. Yeah, so I don't even know the lyrics. Dear Mr. Fantasy, play a solid tune. Well, that'll have to wait. You don't get your song today. Fascinating. This is part of the sadhana, the satsang, is you don't get your song. People are wanting their song. Where's my song? Dear Mr. Fantasy, where's my song? Play a tune. Make it snappy. You know, come on. And of course people take drugs and they listen to music because they want their song to sound perfect. They want the music to free them from the fear of eternal disorientation, the continuity problem that we all have, all suffer, the great gigantic problem, which is the only problem that we have. They want that to be solved. So they try to tune in to the music entirely and get lost in it. And I know, because I certainly, if anyone can get lost in a song, I certainly can. I can even add, it's an amazing thing I found out, that I add notes and inflections that are not even there when I'm listening to the music to make it sound better. I used to do that all the time. for instance, I used to listen to a song of George Jones over and over and over before I went to bed. And by the time I listened to it so many times, it sounded incredible. And then I went back later the next day, I listened to the song, and I said, yeah, right here he does this. And he didn't. I said, wait a minute. I heard that when I listened to the song. I heard all this stuff. And I said, he's not doing that. I said, well, I was adding in my own mind, in real time, adding inflections and beautiful stuff and making the song sound better. That's actually, when you listen to music, that's what you're doing. You're actually tailoring it. Your mind tailors it. And so I could do that and make the song just sound incredible. And the best songs for me were the ones that enabled me to do that the most, where they state the song is simple and it lets you make it sound better in your own mind. But no matter how great you make a song sound, it doesn't solve the continuity problem. Because who's doing the listening is the question. Who's doing the listening? Senses are doing the listening. What are senses? Death, vulnerability. Part of the training program of death. The entire experience of listening to a song is all set in the context of death. It's just a beautiful frame you're putting around death. All right? Can't have the frame without the picture. Frame without a picture is meaningless. Is it says, hey, you're feeling down? I know this another musician that'll do it for you. Really? Yeah. I didn't tell you about this before, but if you just listen to this one, it's gonna be it. It's gonna do it for you. You say, oh great. Who's that ego? So recently the ego has done that a number of artists for me, saying, you just listen to this artist and you won't worry about the continuity problem anymore. And I said, uh-oh, it's hooking me again. Brenda Lee, I never listened to Brenda Lee, but I found out she's one of the best singers in country music, period. You know, fabulous singer, one of the greatest. And I never even really paid any attention to her. And the ego says, hey, listen to Brenda Lee, and that's going to be good enough. I said, that's not, wears off. Then Dion, just introduced me to Dion. Of course, I heard Dion growing up, but I didn't realize what a great singer he was, actually. And what a great artist. Tremendous, one of the best. And so I listened to Dion recently. I said, huh, yeah, the doo-wop stuff, the really good doo-wop stuff from, you know, the Bronx and Brooklyn and stuff like that. That was a whole era. You know, a lot of people from that era still, you know, into doo-wop and that music, and they just listen to it. Oh, it's just like, it's so dreamy and romantic and everything. And you think, if I just get lost in this music, lost in this romance. Getting lost in the romance is how we try to solve the continuity problem. How the ego tries to solve it for us. You know, basically, the only reason why we have anything to do with the ego at this point is we believe the ego can solve the continuity problem for us, or we believe it has to. So we just say, ego, please help me, you know, I'm desperate, can you please, I'm terrified by this fear of eternal disorientation. So please, can you save me from that? And the ego says, of course. Here, I got some music for you, just start listening to this stuff. And the music's not enough, here, I got some drugs for you, you know. Oh, that's not good enough. Well, here's another musician. Here's another style. Here's this. And you keep thinking, oh, okay. Maybe I just combine it all just right. And I become very artful in living. Maybe that'll do the job. I know how to, when to meditate, when to listen to music, how to have the right relationships with people, how to cook right, how to exercise right, how to be happy, how to, you know, all this stuff. I just get all this stuff right. maybe then I'll be finally be happy and be saved. This terrible inner fear will disappear. Of course, those gurus who teach that, they find great fame and fortune. And they think that'll help them, you see. That'll help them solve the continuity problem. They're the big shot gurus. It doesn't. Pay attention to that. Pay attention to all this stuff. The big shot gurus, the big shot musicians, the big shot artists. My gosh, I can tell you stories. Sad stories. You already know them, though. You already know them. Don't be another sad story yourself. Be humble and recognize your mistakes, like I am trying to do here, showing you can do it. It's not so terrible. You can do it. You can admit. I mean, I admit I got tricked, I got trapped, and I tried to, you know, make the perfect music, thinking that they would help people be saved. And of course, the muse, which is the ego, in the guise of in a guise which seems marketable to you, will tell you this is the way, this is what you have to do, and you're special. I'll tell you, oh, you've got special talent, and you can do it. You can make the perfect music, you know, and perfect art, perfect poetry, perfect dress, perfectly perfect cook, perfect person, perfect this, perfect that. Always trying to inspire us that we can do it. No, we can't. No, we cannot. Musicians, and they're still chasing that end of that rainbow, and they get into all sorts of substance abuses. They figure, oh, I almost sang the perfect song. If I just use something to enhance my singing, that'll do it. So it's better late than never that we wake up. Better late than never, for sure. We have to determine, you know, how did we go wrong? How did we? That's a song, isn't it? Well, I'm tired of traveling. Well, I'm tired of traveling down this rocky old road. This old heart of mine is hurting from a heavy load. Only Jesus knows the way my heart went wrong. But the Lord, He knows I'm about to bring it on home. Too long, and I'm bringing it home. All right, so only Jesus knows the way my heart went wrong. You have to know the way your heart went wrong. I mean, you have to repent. You have to say, yeah, you know what? I did fall. I did think that maybe I can get help salvation out this way. You know, you do fall in this world. I fell in this world. I came in with good intentions, and I fell. Fell away from grace, fell away from clarity, fell away, and I thought, hey, I don't need clarity. I've got this music. If I could just make music clear enough, then that's good enough. No, it's not good enough. And it's a terrible cataclysmic mistake, actually. Brutal mistake. All the while the muse saying, hey, I'm dancing to it. I like it, you know. So that keeps you going down the wrong road. You know, the muse is like a beautiful person dressed in beautiful style who's tripping down this road and saying, hey, I'm dancing to your music. You know, I like it. Look how happy and animated I am. That you got to do a little more, all the while leading you down this road, you know, to ruination, to frustration, to supreme frustration, because you can't, it doesn't work, and you think it's your fault, and you think if you just try a little harder, you'll get it. But you're trying to accomplish the impossible. You're going down the wrong road. then the scenery gets worse and worse and worse, and where the muse is still dancing, saying, come on, Mr. Fantasy, play me a tune, one that'll make me happy. You are the reason I've been waiting so long. So the muse is trouble. Big, 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 big trouble. But you ask for it. I mean, you're saying, hey, I want to avoid the continuity problem. And it's too much work to look. I don't think I can solve it. So help me, muse, help me find another way. And of course, the muse shows up. The ego presents the muse in your life. And someone who seems to be super enthused about what you're doing, and if you just do a little better, they say you'll be saved, you'll save everybody, all this kind of stuff. Nothing worse than a tortured artist, you know. Although there are tortured people in every walk of life, because every walk of life we're trying to perfect something. We're trying to, you know, so that it saves. Saves us from the continuity problem, fear of eternal disorientation. And none of it does. None of it does. When we decided to embark upon a training program to learn how to die, the Holy Spirit had not yet made its presence felt in reality. It hadn't been activated by the Prime Creator. Maybe hadn't even been created yet. And so we don't know about the Holy Spirit. We don't know about it. So we think we're the ones that have to solve the continuity problem. And so that's why we're so messed up. And keep doubling down on arrogance. So when I became aware of this capacity for clarification, I said, what is this? What is this? You know, I didn't know what it was. And gradually I learned that this is something that God has created for us. And it's one with us, it's within us, and we have access to it. And gradually, you know, I said, well, I'll call it whatever, grace of God, Holy Spirit. But it's there. It's definitely there. But it wasn't there before. So we're simply ignorant of this capacity within us. And we keep saying, come on, keep playing that rock and roll. I want some more rock and roll. And I look at lifelong musicians, I look at lifelong music aficionados, etc. And I can see very plainly that they're still completely in the loop, and it just, you know, they're just stuck, treading, spinning their tires, as it were. It's not it. If any art at all should be performance art, okay, meaning that the meta message has to be primary. Now, you can have performance art that gives the wrong meta message, for sure. That says, hey, let's double down on arrogance, let's double down on art, you know, that can be there. And there's some performance artists in the world who are like that. But you can also use performance art to point out the true meta message, the true message of salvation. And we won't be stuck forever, you know, singing shoo-bop, shoo-bee-shoo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. Shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. We won't be going singing over and over and over. Shoo-bop, 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 shoo-bop. And that's a good thing. I don't even know the lyrics to that. Oh well, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter, because we don't want to be singing the shoo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. Oh, oh, oh yeah. And we don't want to be caught up in that. So music should be interrupted, tell you the truth. Music should be interrupted. Now, if I can ever get to that and do it, and people say, hey, that's... I don't think people like it so much. here it is. I don't think people like that so much. They say, come on, play me a song, Mr. Fantasy. And shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. I can't forget the first time I saw you walking by. I don't got it. My heart stopped for a moment. There was love in your eyes. Something. It's hard to get that one. But, so, you see, music talks about romance. And romance is the ultimate diversion, isn't it? So music combines the two. It says, I can't forget the first time I saw you walking by. My heart stopped for a moment. There was love in your eyes. So, music combines romance with the music. And that is what is such a potent diversion for us. Because that goes into our fantasy. Dear Mr. Fantasy is singing a song. Very distracting, isn't it? We think, oh, if only I could have that moment when it says, I can't forget the first time I saw you. Oh, I can't forget the first time I saw you walking by. For a moment, there was love in your eyes. Oh, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-bee-doo-bop. And I had to find a way to make you look my way. So, it's talking about that first moment when you're young and you see someone walking down the street and your heart stops for a moment and you know there was love in your eyes and it's like, ah, everything fades to black, right? The whole world fades to black. The continuity problem fades to black. And you hear bells ringing. It's like, oh, you're so distracted. I have to find a way. So, I don't know you, goes, I don't know you, but I love you, and that feels so strange to me, and I know that I want you, not to have you, stop girl, turn around and walk. So, there you go. It's got it all, right? It's got the doo-wop, and I don't know, a strange feeling, but I gotta have you, and once you stop, turn around, look at me, I've gotta figure a way. So suddenly your mind is involved in this incredible quest to have time stop, everything stop for a moment. And so the song reminds you, yeah, tune into that. You see, potent stuff, very potent stuff. So we feel like music can somehow make the world go away. Make the world go away. And take it off my shoulder. Yeah. So musicians are supposed to make the world go away. Take it off our shoulders. And then we'll shell out money. Hey, want to go see your concert? Want to buy your stuff? We want to make you a star. Make you a superstar if you can make the world go away for us. People never trusted me. Wonder why. They said, wait a minute, he might stop playing at any time and start preaching. Yeah. I remember when Daddy died. He said the Lord was by his side. In his last breath, he said, I'm a going to the promised land. That's when Mama told us all that she had heard the call, and Mama would be a preacher man. Mama was a preacher man. Mama was God's right hand. Ah, yeah. So I might start preaching. Might be a man that's dressed in black, be a hobo by the railroad track, going anywhere that I want to go one of these days. Might stop singing, might stop playing, might start preaching, might say, hey folks, have you ever thought about salvation? You ever thought about that salvation? Really, what you need is a new mode of perception, a stable mode of perception. That this mode of perception that we have is completely unstable. It gives us a constant feeling of death, of vulnerability, to destruction, to annihilation, actually. Because if we feel if we didn't perceive anything, come on, fade to black, we would be annihilated. And the very means of perception that we're using, this flesh, is of course subject to annihilation at any moment. And so we feel that we, our spirit, is subject to annihilation at any moment. So it's the perception, it's the one, that which is doing the perceiving, that is the problem. And is that which has to be replaced, exchanged, and we think, oh my God, that means I have to die? No. We simply are aware of a new means of perception. Spiritual perception doesn't rely on the body. How about that? Do you wanna go? Do you wanna go straight to Hawaii? Me. I heard about all the pretty girls with the grass skirts down to their knees. All my life, I wanted to see the island called Hawaii. Go to Hawaii, Hawaii, straight to Hawaii. Oh, do you wanna come along with me? Yeah, that's the Beach Boys. Go to Hawaii. On the Tammy Show. Go to Hawaii. Do you wanna go? Wow, Hawaii. It's got it all. It's got the music. It's got the pretty girls. It's got the surf. It's got the sun. It's got the climate. It's got the beautiful young pedal, the steel guitar, and everything's just like, whoa. Just chill out there. What continuity problem? Do you wanna go straight to Hawaii? Hawaii, Hawaii. Do you wanna go straight to Hawaii, Hawaii, straight to Hawaii? That's the Brian Wilson. Hawaii, oh, do you wanna come along with me? Woo, and woo, doo-wop, doo-dee-wop, shoo-bop, shoo-dee-doo-bop, shoo-bop, shoo-dee-doo-bop, oh, shibop, 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 Hawaii, Hawaii. Said, hey, let's go to Hawaii, shibidubop, let's go to Hawaii, let's get it, the hula, let's have the flower lays, let's forget all about the continuity problem. Only problem is, what is that which is doing the perceiving? I should put a flower lay on myself right now if I don't have one. Do you wanna go straight to Hawaii?
What do we got?
Oh, as usual, as usual, as usual. So, even the one that's got the blues, you know, sometimes the blues we think will take us out of the continuity problem. At first, we're sad, we're so sad, we get into depression. See, depression's gonna solve it. Depression's gonna solve it. The sun comes up, the sun comes up and brings the dawn, as usual. When I awake, I'll find you gone, as usual. But I can't find a way to let this crazy heart of mine forget. I pretend you're still beside me, as usual. Each evening I take a walk, as usual. I make believe that we still talk, as usual. People always stop and stare. I guess that they don't see you there. Don't they know you'll always be right here, as usual. Yeah, so sad, right? Today I looked at my mirror, as usual. I told myself that you're still here, as usual. And as I stood there, telling lies, the tears began to fill my eyes. I guess I know I'm only fooling myself, as usual. The blues make you so sad you forget about the continuity problem, right? Wrong. Because who's experiencing the blues? Death, instability. I really got into the blues after the happy stuff didn't work. I could do both, the pop stuff and the blues. I was very much a blues man, as a matter of fact. I could play the blues like really, 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 really well. And it didn't work. I got into depression. I was super depressed, and that didn't work. But it certainly was very distracting. I'll tell you that. Because the blues can be so distracting. Here we go. That you can't think of the continuity problem. You say, well, I'm not worried about that. I'm worried about how terrible I feel. I see that worried look upon, see upon your face. You got your troubles, I've got mine. She's found somebody else to take your place. You got your troubles, I've got mine. I too have lost my love today. All of my dreams have blown away. Not just like you, I sit, wonder why. You got your troubles, I've got mine. You need some sympathy, well, so do I. You got your troubles, I've got mine. She used to love me, she used to love me, this I know. And it didn't seem like so long ago. And it goes on from there. First time I played that one, so it's a little ragged. That sheet goes. that's a heartbreaker, right? You got your troubles, I got mine. That's the blues, and that's another style of trying to cure the continuity problem. Now, what I did was I got into the depression, whatever state, and then I tried to find a music that would take me out of it, as it were. So you got depression, severe depression, and you play the blues and say, ah, it makes the depression go away. So the problem with musicians is they end up taking on the ills of the world and trying to figure out a song. Dear Mr. Fantasy, play me a song that'll take me out of the blues, take me out of depression. But depression itself is a means of trying to avoid the continuity problem. Say, fatigue is another one. I'm so tired. How can I possibly focus on the continuity problem? I'm too tired to do that. So I did that too, fatigue. I'm too tired, I can't focus on it. Oh my gosh, here's another one. Dun, dun, dun. Here comes that, it's wrong key. Here comes that rainy day feeling again. And soon my tears will be falling like rain. It always seems to be a Monday. I'm left over memories of Sunday. Always spent with you before the clouds appeared and took away my sunshine. Here comes that rainy day fever again. Be dreaming of you, baby, in vain. Your face is always on my mind, girl. I'm hoping soon you're gonna find, girl, your way back to me. Cause if you say you'll stay, the rainy days will be the rainy days will go away. Oh man, first time on that one too. Here comes that rainy day feeling again. So, romance, with all its ups and downs, etc., distracts us supremely from thinking about, wait a minute, I got a big problem. I got this feeling like I'm going to be eternally disoriented. What do I do about it? Whoa, you know, wow, that's scary. And we don't listen to the Holy Spirit saying, hey, I've got the answer for you. You got your troubles, I got mine. And we keep thinking, oh, you got your troubles, I got mine. Ah, I've got so much troubles, I got so much troubles. We don't listen because we're too scared. Spiritual path seems very scary. Itchy apart. Over bridge of sighs. To rest my eyes in the shades of green. That doesn't work. What did you see there? I got high. So people get high trying to be happy. Different people do different things. Some get real low, get real depressed. It's all the same thing. It's all an attempt to flee from the continuity problem. It's all an attempt to say, I can't look at that right now. I can't look at that right now. I'm too ... You're filling the blanks. And then there's always the escapism song, right? Instead of listening to the Holy Spirit, and it's what you really need to do. I can be any. That doesn't fit. I won't have to chop no wood. I can be better. I can be good. I can be any way that I feel one of these days. So much for that. escapism. Ah, living on, living on. Well, you see, the ego says, come on, play those songs. Play those songs. You know those songs. I say, yeah, I do. But I'm trying to focus on salvation here, folks. Living on, living on, living on easy street, street, with a dog, dog and a Persian cat. Living on easy street, we don't need much more than that. Man, I used to know the song. I practiced the song. I knew it cold just a couple days ago. Now, I don't know it. Slipped away. That's okay, because I've been doing something more important. So like a real hardcore musician will say, oh no, I gotta do that song. Oh yeah, got it. I can do it. I can do it. I can do it. Just a minute. I can do it. I say, forget it. Forget it. Forget it. Forget it. I can sing it. No, I don't want the chords. Living on easy street with a dog and a Persian cat. Living on easy street. We don't need this or that. Our bills, they're gonna be due, and the baby will soon be too. But we draw our welfare check this week, living on easy street, easy street, street, yeah. Living on easy street, with a dog and a Persian cat. Living on easy street, we don't need much more than that. Much more than that. See, that's where it falls apart. Much more than that. Let it fall apart. Let the song fall apart. Let the song fall apart is the key. Let the song fall apart. We're afraid if the song falls apart that we're going to freak. We're going to freak out. No, we don't freak out. Because there's a safety net there. Because the Holy Spirit is there. When you let the song fall apart, you say, everything's okay. Everything's okay. I didn't become totally disoriented. Why? Now, intellectualism is another way. Lots of ways in the world. Been down most of those paths. And when it falls apart, you assume, well, what happens is, You assume you're going to be freaked out and eternally disoriented. And then you apply extreme defense to that. So like when intellectualism, I remember when intellectualism fell apart, when music fell apart for me, when intellectual, all this stuff fell apart, I took refuge in depression. It was a defense against eternal disorientation. So we freak out and try to apply a remedy, another defense remedy. Bandage the wound, like, oh my God, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna be eternally disoriented. Hey, I gotta get depression, I gotta grab hold of something, you know, clutch at some straw. Instead of just look, wait, say, wait a minute, let me just see. Okay, I fell apart. You know, in satsang, what happens is the people go up and they have their shtick, and they have their defense, what's always working, and the guru helps them come to the end of that shtick. And then the person is like, oh my God, I don't have this defense anymore. I'm going to be eternally disoriented. And they, you know, jump at something else, and guru tries to help them, just say, hey, it's okay. No worries. And the people often break down and sobbing and tears, and just like, I thought I was going to die. I thought I was going to be worse than death, way worse than death. And it didn't happen. Of course, then they think the guru's the answer. And that's the problem for the guru. A big problem for the guru. And the guru has to let them down with that one. Say, no, the guru's not the answer. The Holy Spirit's the answer. A new mode of perception is the answer. Living on easy street, street, with a dog and a Persian cat. Living on easy street, it don't get much better than that. Well, the baby at home. Well, bills are soon, our bills, they're gonna be due. And the baby at home makes two. Baby at home, baby will soon make two. But we draw our welfare checks next week, living on Easy Street. There you go. Where our old icebox is empty, and the cupboard is bare of beans. We don't have a pot, but we don't have a garden, but we're fulfilling our dreams. There we go. We're fulfilling our dreams in a two-room shack on a 20-foot lot. The way we live, it's a perfect spot. Living on love, living on love, and it sure is cheap. Living on Easy Street. There you go. Goes a little slower than that. Just trying to get it. So the guru brings you to the end of your path, your end of realizing it doesn't work. I remember when my intellectual shtick came to an end. And I went into a severe depression. Didn't have a guru to help me out at that time. So, ideally, the satsang goes, and you come to the end. What happens, like in satsang, a lot of times is you have your spiritual shtick, and you bring it to the guru, and it doesn't work. One second here. Yeah. So. The spiritual stick comes to an end, and the guru says, but who's, you know, who is experiencing this? Well, you know, that something like that. And it's like you realize, oh my gosh, you know, this is just all trying to avoid this perceptual problem we have. Ideally, that's what the guru can do. Living on Easy Street with a dog and a Persian cat. Living on Easy Street, we don't need much more than that.
Is that right?
Living on Easy Street, we don't need much more than that. Our bills are gonna be due. Baby will soon be two.
But we earn, but we
draw our welfare check this week. Living on Easy Street. So we're afraid of the guru because we're afraid we're going to be thrown into eternal disorientation. Because you know, no matter what you do, the guru is going to say that's not it. That's not it. Now, the problem is that there's some people who figure this out kind of shrewdly, and the guru thing is their shtick. Okay? So bringing everyone, it's easy to do if you want to be a non-dualist. It's easy. I mean, if you're shrewd enough, you can, there's a lot of shrewd people in the world, business people, etc. Very shrewd. Business people are very shrewd, actually, very shrewd. And they figure out, oh, all I gotta do is say, yeah, but who's asking the question? You know, who's looking? Who's seeking? Who's trying to figure it out? Who is this trying to figure it out? They learn the non-dual shtick, and then they can set up shop and make a lifetime out of being a non-dual teacher. But they're not a guru. They don't have the new perception. They don't have the new perception. And so then when they can bust your shtick, as it were, but then you don't have the answer for you. So then you become addicted to them, as it were. They become your new shtick. That's a dangerous thing. A lot of gurus are that way, actually. A lot. Living on Easy Street with a dog and a Persian cat. Living on Easy Street, it don't get much better than that. Well, our bills are gonna be due, And the baby will soon be two. But we draw our welfare check this week, living on Easy Street. So you can tell the real gurus, you can tell. It's not easy though, because the business ones are very shrewd. But they aren't really into the gurus thing. They can hit a wrong chord, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, whatever, you know. Just they can stop the guru shtick. They can be truly detached and disinterested from it, not even, you know, it's just, they realize it's just something, a crutch, as it were. But they have the new perception, the perception of oneness. They have this stable perception. So, you know, living on Easy Street with a dog and, ooh, it's the wrong chord. Oh, well, don't need the song anyway. Stop the song, doesn't matter. In other words, the real gurus are not so smooth, okay? They seem kind of ragged. Generally, the business person, and, you know, women are mastering the guru shtick very quickly right now, as a matter of fact. So you may have more female gurus in the world than males right now, and soon, for sure. And they're very shrewd, too, extremely. A female business person can be uber shrewd, actually. They're very good at it. Maybe a little too good at it, you know what I mean? And so, they're too slick. They're too slick. And when they try not to be too slick, that's too slick, too. They're good at faking not being slick, too. But you can tell there's something slick here. Something slick. Hey, slick. You know. Living on Easy Street with a dog and a Siamese cat. Living on Easy Street, it don't get much better than that. Where are the bills they're gonna be due? And the baby will soon be two. But we draw our welfare check this week. Living on Easy Street. So a lot of the spiritual teachers in the world are actually just very shrewd business people. And they're not enlightened. They don't have the new perception. They don't have the Holy Spirit's perception. They do not. They do not. But they have an endless bag of stuff to give you. When they bust your shtick, they have an endless bag of stuff to give you. Here's this, try this mantra, try this meditation, do this. And you think, oh, they have the answer. They know the answer, no. But they know how to hook you on a new shtick, which is profitable for them, okay? Very profitable for them. Our old ice box is empty. Our old ice box is empty. And the cupboard is bare of beans. Yeah. So, This information helps ease us into the solution, right? Because the business person gurus have been part of the problem, actually. Big part of the problem. And we've wasted a lot of time on that. And unfortunately now, just when we figured out the guru shtick for men, because in the past, most gurus were men, we finally started, hey, I'm starting to figure out what happened was the ego brought along the woman guru. And we haven't figured out their shtick very well, as most of us. I actually have. It was very difficult, actually. That's a real, real time delayer. I mean, I'm telling you, the female guru shtick is way more difficult to deal with than the male guru shtick. Way more difficult, because they can always play the victim, you know, play all these various things, the underdog. You know, they got all these other things that they can give you to make you feel guilty, like, hey, it's our turn, how come you're dissing me? They have all this guilt trip they can lay on you, a massive guilt trip. a massive sexist type of thing, or you're just not accepting me because you're prejudiced or sexist, you know, on and on to make you like, oh my gosh, yeah, this is must. How bad of me to think that this is just a shrewd business shtick here, you know? How terrible of me, how rotten of me. Living on Easy Street with the dog and dog and a Siamese cat. See, first we had a Persian cat. Now we have living on Easy Street with a dog and a Siamese cat. Well, so now we got a Siamese cat to deal with instead of the Persian cat, as it were. So we got the female gurus now are coming out in droves and droves and droves and droves and droves. And people are just like falling like flies for it, you know. Living on Easy Street, we aren't. I'm free as a bird in the wild blue yonder. Tonight I'm gonna hit town like a roll of thunder. Tonight I'm gonna paint the town, show all the other guys how to get around. No more crying, no more moaning. My baby left town, she left me this morning. Free as a breeze, do as I please. And baby, that's the life for me. This is a guy that's crying about his baby left him, you know. His means of distracting himself from the continuity problem has left him. And he said, oh, I'm free as a breeze. Well, I'm free as a breeze. I'm free as a breeze. I'm tired of steady dating, tired of sitting home crying and waiting. I've had a lot of time to do a lot of thinking. Who knows, tonight I might do a little drinking. I don't have a care, don't have a worry. I go where I please and I don't have to hurry. Freeze, please, do as I please. And baby, that's the life for me. Not really. He's in there bar drinking. Because he says, oh my God, I don't have this distraction from the continuity problem. What am I going to do? I got to start hitting the bottle quickly from one addiction to the other. So now we are, you know, our baby left us. Now what do? Oh, the guru, run to the guru. Now we've got these female gurus. Oh, that'll work. That addiction will really work. You know, that's what people think. Say, finally, I got a new addiction. Is it better than the other one, the old one? The guru will keep me fed with distractions so I never have to face the continuity problem and say, how is this really solved? How is this really solved? What is this problem really? You look at it, really look at it, and you say, oh, that's a great big old problem. That's a really big one. That's a gigantic problem. That's such an enormous problem that all this stuff that I'm doing, there's no way it's going to solve it. And then you say, help, what really solves this? And that's when the Holy Spirit shows up and says, hey, I can solve it. I have solved it. I am the solution to it. And there's an air of certitude there that the slick business gurus with all their shtick, they don't have it. Holy Spirit has it. And then you say, wow, if I want to solve this, I got to get serious. I can't keep fooling around with these, you know, this guru shtick, at least the fake ones. All right, I think I hear someone coming.